Heliosiesmology, listening to the sun. A wave is simply a periodic disturbance that moves. In this video, we will look at several examples of a special type of wave called a standing wave and discuss how astronomers use standing waves in the sun to learn about its interior. This simulation illustrates waves on a string. The top panel displays a wave traveling to the right. The second panel displays a wave traveling to the left, a reflection of the first wave. The bottom panel illustrates the addition of the two waves. At each point where two waves overlap, they either add together to make a bigger wave in constructive interference or cancel each other out in destructive interference. Note that some locations, like the ends, always stay put. These are called nodes, while the middle alternates between constructive and destructive. These are called antinodes. A standing wave is the addition of a wave and its reflection, two identical waves traveling in opposite directions. A standing wave appears to be fixed in its location because the nodes and antinodes don't move. The wavelength of a standing wave is closely related to the length of a string. Here, the length of string is twice the wavelength of the wave, which is known as the fundamental. It has one antinode right in the middle. The simulation now shows the first overtone, where the length of the string is equal to the wavelength of the wave. It has two antinodes. Here is the second overtone, where the wavelength is two-thirds the length of the string. It has three antinodes. This simulation only illustrates the few waves where a wave and its reflection interfere constructively at fixed locations and create a standing wave. This apparatus is useful for displaying standing waves on a string. On the left, a vibrator moves up and down very rapidly, creating a wave traveling to the right. One can control the frequency of the vibration, as well as the velocity v of the wave, for this type of string through hanging weights. Now the apparatus has been configured to show a standing wave whose wavelength is two-thirds of the string length. Here is a standing wave whose wavelength is one-half the length of the string. Standing waves are the major physical concept at work in musical instruments. Another example of a standing wave is blowing across the top of a skinny pop bottle. The air is free to move at the top of the bottle, an antinode, and cannot move at the bottom of the bottle, a node. The wavelength of the main sound wave produced is four times the height of the bottle, as again, we need to picture a complete cycle of a wave. Since the velocity of sound and air is about 340 meters per second, we could estimate the frequency of the sound produced using the speed equals frequency times wavelength equation. Something very similar can be done with these aluminum rods. If I create some longitudinal vibrations, a standing wave is created, which quickly gets obnoxiously loud. The metal cannot move where I am holding it, a node, and it vibrates freely at the ends, antinodes. So the wavelength of the main wave in the rod is twice the rod length. In both of these examples, many other waves are created, but they are quickly canceled out. Only standing waves are relatively long-lived. Note that if we set up vibrations in a slightly longer rod, we get a lower pitch. The wavelength, twice the length of the rod, is larger. The velocity of sound in aluminum is the same, and thus the frequency is smaller. We perceive a smaller frequency as a lower pitch. Let's explore this further using a peer instruction question. Supposing that we blow over the pop bottle and then pour some water into the bottle and blow over it again, how will the pitch change? Classroom students should follow normal procedures or instructor guidelines. Viewers not in a classroom should record your vote and explain your reasoning on a piece of paper. Please pause this video and answer the question. I will first blow into the empty pop bottle and now into the bottle with some water in the bottom. Note that we hear a higher pitch. The wavelength of the sound is still four times the height of the cavity, and wavelength is inversely proportional to frequency. The velocity of sound and air remains the same. Thus, with a smaller wavelength, we get a larger frequency, which we perceive as a higher pitch. Our last apparatus is known as Rubens Tube. This tube has a speaker at one end, a number of holes drilled in the top, and is fed with a source of propane gas, which is ignited. When sound is applied by University of Nebraska physicist Christian Binnick, we can see the resulting standing waves in the flames. So, where do standing waves show up in astronomy? Heliosiesmology is the study of pressure waves, basically sound waves, in the sun. A multitude of wavelengths of sound are created by turbulence in the convection in the outer regions of the sun. destructive interference cancels out all but the standing waves, where the surface of the sun creates nodes. The speed and wavelength of a wave depends on the density of the medium through which it travels. Waves in the sun curve due to increasing density in deeper layers and reflect back off of the surface due to the sudden change in density. Long wavelength standing waves penetrate more deeply into the sun and travel more rapidly, while short wavelength standing waves remain near the surface and travel more slowly. These waves are observed through Doppler shifts of light emitted from the solar surface. This graphic illustrates how some portions of the surface are moving towards us, shown as blue-shifted regions, and some away from us, shown as red-shifted regions. Here is an actual velocity image from the gong network. The image was obtained by subtracting a velocity image from one obtained a minute earlier. Heliosiesmology has been instrumental in refining estimates of the percentage of helium in the sun, the opacity used in solar models, and the depth of the convective zone. More teaching materials can be found on the web at astro.unl.edu.